So we're still talking about section 1.3, inverses, exponential, and logarithmic functions. So we left on part C, which talks about inverses. Okay, so let's define an inverse. Given a function f, a function fcn, f inverse is the inverse of f provided when y equals f of x, f inverse of y equals x. Okay? So if I look at my original equation and I just apply f inverse to both sides, f of f inverse of x should equal x, right? And what is this? What am I doing here with these two? What operation is that?
So you're taking 1 over f inverse.
Oh, no.
Wait.
Okay, so this is like some of the worst notation in math. This is the functional inverse. This is not f to the negative first power. Okay? This is the functional inverse. This does not mean, so f inverse of x does not mean 1 over f of x. It's terrible notation.
Does it do that by square root?
Yes. So the inverse is kind of the opposite, right? But what operation is this? This is composition, right? This is like f inverse of f of x. That's this, right? So it's composition. This is the worst notation in math. Because everybody looks at that negative one power and thinks like this. Okay, so this is how we get this. Because composition with the inverse, f inverse of f of x, should equal x. So that's where that definition comes from. That's because, like Reese said, you're basically doing the opposite, right? If you have x squared, the opposite of x squared is the square root, right? Things like that. So let's do another definition. A function is 1-to-1 or 1-to-1, either way you want to write it, if each f of x value corresponds to exactly 1 y value. I'm not going to say exactly. I'm going to say at most. So what does this mean graphically? So each x value corresponds to exactly one y value. Well, I'm sorry.
Yeah, shouldn't be the other way around.
Yes. So each f of x value, that's my y value, corresponds to exactly one x value. Bless you. So let me do some examples, which are one-to-one. Should have made that in blue, sorry friends. Okay, so each f of x value corresponds to at most one x value. So do you think that this one is 1-to-1?
Yep.
Yes. Do you think that this one is 1-to-1? Some people say no. Tell me why. I think you got it though.
Two x values for the same y value.
Two x values for the same y value. So maybe I have this y value that corresponds to this x value and this x value, right? So this y value corresponds to two x values. Each of these y values correspond to one x value, right? This y value corresponds to two x values. So graphically, what am I doing?
It's the horizontal line test.
It's the horizontal line test. So if I'm talking about when something is a function, I'm doing the vertical line test, right? I can only intersect at one point. If I'm talking about a function being 1-to-1, I'm talking about the horizontal line test, and I can only intersect each function at one point. So this is 1-to-1, is not. What do you think about number 3? Does it pass the horizontal line test? Is the function 1-to-1? Sure, choose this one.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, it intersects 3 times even, right? So, no, doesn't pass the horizontal line test. What do you guys think about this one? My drawing's a little bad. But look, it intersects so many points right here, right? It intersects all these y values, or all these x values, right? So it's not 1-to-1. So, does anybody know why I'm talking about a function being 1-to-1 if I'm talking about inverses, right? This section, part C, is inverse functions. Why am I talking about 1-to-1? How does that relate, right? Does anybody have an idea yet? Got to bring it back. What do you know graphically about inverse functions? Josh?
You flip the x and the y values.
You flip the x and the y values. Good.
So if you have two y values that equal one x, then it wouldn't be a function.
Awesome. Did everybody hear what Josh said?
Can you repeat it?
Will you repeat it, Josh?
If for an inverse function, you would change the x and the y values, and like for the example number two there, if you had the, like, if x equaled 1 and y equaled 2, those two y values would equal 1 and negative 1. So then if you changed it to the y values, then...
So the deal with inverses is you're switching x and y. So we're going to talk about the steps to finding inverses. First step is switch x and y. So graphically, that means I'm flipping my function over the line y equals x. Does that make sense? So if I'm switching x and y graphically, I'm to find an inverse, I'm flipping over the line y equals x. So let me do an example. So let's say I have number 2. So let's look at number 2. Let's look at its possible inverse. So if I have number 2, I have a function like this. I want to flip that over the line y equals x. Because I'm switching x and y. The first step to finding inverses is switch x and y. So this is f. I wish I had another color. Let me do it in pencil. So graphically, if I wanted to change that, that would be like this. Flipping over the line y equals x would be like this, right? That is not a function, right? So this is f inverse. Hang on, f inverse is not a function. So if a function does not pass the horizontal line test, then its inverse will not pass the vertical line test. So its inverse would not be a function. That's why we're talking about one-to-one. If a function is not one-to-one, it does not have an inverse. So let me see if I can write that. You did a good job saying it, though, Josh. So if a function is not one-to-one, which means it does not then its inverse flipped over the line. Maybe I should say mirrored. It's a little better. Then its inverse, which is mirrored over the line y equals x, will not pass the vertical line test. Which means it's not a function. Does that make sense? My English is mediocre. Okay.
Exactly. Nobody knows.
Yeah.
It's probably not my first, but it's the only one I know now. Okay, so let's do a theorem. Okay, so are we good with this? So a function has to be one-to-one in order to have an inverse. Okay? So now we have a theorem. Theorem 1.1. Existence of inverse functions. So we're basically going to put all this stuff that we just talked about. This is just kind of a side note. All this stuff that we just talked about, let's put it in terms of the theorem. So let f be a one-to-one function. See, it's already required. It has to be a one-to-one function. If we're talking about the existence of inverses, I have to have that. With domain D and range R. Then F has a unique inverse. F inverse, right? Not to the negative 1 power, F inverse. With domain R and range D. So there again, we're switching our X's and our Y's, right? Our domain is all possible x values. Our range is all possible y values. So the domain of f is the range of f inverse. The range of f is the domain of f inverse. Okay? So that's a theorem. So let f be a one-to-one function. It has to pass the horizontal line test with domain D and range R. So it's kind of saying if f is a one-to-one function, then there exists a unique inverse. Okay. So now let's talk about the steps to solving. So the first step, Josh already told us, is switch X and Y. And that tells us graphically we're mirrored over the line Y equals X, right? Step two, solve for Y. Step three, rewrite. There's lots of coughing. Rewrite y as f inverse. Okay, so those are the steps. Okay, so examples. I'm going to take attendance. I know everybody's here, but I have to practice names. There's no class on Monday, right?
No.
Okay, let me write down number 5 so you guys can... I think you guys are smart enough to try it on your own. First, where is my Y? Right, first step is switch X and Y. Where's my Y? F of X equals Y, right? So here I'm going to write. So maybe first step is write Y equals F of X. But I'm going to write this is X equals 3Y plus 2. Step 2 is solve for Y. step three is rewrite y equals f inverse of x. So you guys do this one. After the first step, you're just getting y equals, right? You guys can do that. Nation. David. Rose Angel. John. Cole. Garrett. Emily. Josh. Tyler. Patrick. Liam. Malik. Reese. And Ian. Got it. Okay, so what'd you guys get? Here, I'll just do it. I subtract 2 from both sides. I divide both sides by 3. And then step 3 is rewrite y equals f inverse of x. Did I get it right? Did you guys get it right? It's not hard, right? Like I said, chapter 1 is just kind of a review of algebra stuff. All right, number 6. G of x equals 3x squared plus 2x minus 1. What do you guys think? Okay, so you're saying step 1, switch x and y. Okay, now what? Solve for y, right? How do I solve for y here?
Quadratic formula, or, well, you don't even need to do that. You just, you can factor this, right?
How? This is a trick question, right? I have y equals x squared. X squared is a parabola. It's not 1-to-1, right? Not 1-to-1. It doesn't have an inverse. If you get down here, John has a good idea. Okay, can I factor this? Okay, can I do quadratic equation? Oh my goodness, what the heck can I do, right? You cannot solve for y here. Don't force it. You cannot solve for y. Even if the discriminant is not negative.
Okay.
Doesn't matter. I get to here and I go, okay, if I do the quadratic equation, I'd have y equals this, right? When I solve a quadratic equation, what am I actually finding? I'm actually finding where my function intersects the x-axis, right? You're setting y equals to 0 when you're solving a quadratic. That doesn't tell me anything about the inverse, right? But I like your thinking. But you cannot solve for y. This is not 1-to-1. Therefore, no inverse. That's how you spell inverse, okay? So I've put questions like this on a test before, find the inverse. Somehow people factor out a y, and then they're dividing, and then they're... No, you can't solve for y, right? No inverse. Seven, h of x equals e to the x. If you want to check if it's 1-to-1, you can check on your calculator, right? Okay, 7. H of x equals e to the x. You guys tell me what to write. Oh, we were supposed to graph this too. We'll graph this one. what's the first step? Switch x and y. So x equals e to the y, and I need to solve for y. How do I solve for y? If I ever have the variable in my exponent, what do I need to do? Take the log. So if I ever, whether I'm solving for the inverse, whether I'm solving for the variable, if I ever have my variable in my exponent, I take the log. And that's because exponential and logarithmic are inverses of each other. Okay? So I'm going to take the log of both sides. Okay, so right after this section, we're talking about properties of logs. But can anybody help me? Bring it back. Remember the rules. So why am I always taking the log if my variable is in the exponent?
Because it brings it down.
Because it brings it down. So ln of x, if I have an exponent inside of the logarithmic function, I can bring that variable out front. Okay? That's the whole reason why, if the variable's in the exponent, I take the log, because that's the only way to get that variable out of the exponent. What does ln of e equal?
1.
1? How did you get that?
Well, I just kind of remember it. So am I wrong?
No.
Okay. So
am I already giving you guys too many trick questions that you're like, oh gosh, does that mean anything? So natural log, this invisible base, is what?
E.
So if I do that whole all around the world thing, I'm saying e to the what power equals e? It's 1. Right? This is e to the question mark equals e. Well, if I have base e, those exponents better be equal, so it's 1. So this is ln of x equals y. And I'm going to rewrite y. My last step is rewrite y as f inverse of x equals ln of x. Okay, so let me write down. Okay, so we could graph this and see that they're inverses, right? They're reflected over the line y equals x. I'm going to write down my properties of logs now. Because definitely got to know this stuff to solve. So this is properties of logarithmic functions. 1, I have log b to the x, where x is my exponent inside of the logarithmic function, right? X is my exponent on the inside of my logarithmic function, equals x log b. If I have parentheses around this b or not, b is inside of my log function. I'm taking the log of b, right? If I say of in math, you should be thinking, okay, that's combination, composition, right? Okay, I have another one. Log of AB equals log of A plus log of B. I can go from either side of the equals, right? If I'm given a question like this and it says combine, these have the same base, right? The base is 10. They have the same base. You can combine them to multiplication. Log of A divided by B equals log of A minus log B. And log base B of X equals log of X over log of B. So this is, like, if you don't have one of those fancy calculators, think in your calculator there's some button where you can just put this into your calculator. But if you don't, this is how you compute that. So those are the properties of logs. So we'll do a couple examples next class of how to use those properties. Your homework's due tomorrow. tonight. Any questions?
Are there a lot of things to do with water analytics within calculus? Is this pretty fundamental to what we're doing here?
This is just like an algebra review, really. Like, I teach this in college algebra, but we're going to use it, right? So all of this stuff in chapter one, you should be comfortable using because they're just algebraic skills.